In the name of Allah, the gracious, ever merciful, highly esteemed Mrs. Catherine Gozzi, the wife of the Prime Minister of Malta, highly esteemed Mrs. Michelle Muscat, the wife of the leader of the opposition in Malta, respected speakers, distinguished guests and journalists, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May peace and blessings of Allah be on you all. It is a great honor for us to organize this historic event to commemorate International Women's Day. I'm also glad to announce that the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat Malta has planted an olive tree to commemorate the centenary, and a tag has been attached to the tree with the message of this centenary at the Salmon Family Park, Melliha. This seminar bears witness to the great honor and respect we hold in our actions and words for women. I'm greatly thankful to our highly respected speakers who have spared us their precious time to make this program a success. I also want to show my gratitude to all the guests who have come to join us at this important occasion, and to respected journalists who are present here to cover this special and memorable event. It is also an immense privilege and honor to address this respectful gathering and to share some thoughts on the subject of women in Islam. Islam is the name given by Allah the Almighty to the true religion revealed by God to Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him, for over 1400 years ago. Islam means peace and submission to the will of God. It presents a way of life and gives guidance under all possible situations and covers the entire sphere of human activities. It highlights the rights and obligations for everyone. Islam condemns any discrimination between men and women and prescribes equal rights and duties for them. The founder of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be with him, was extremely keen on improving the condition of women in society and on securing for them a position of dignity and fair and equitable treatment. Islam pays great respect and honor to women and absolutely believes in equality between women and men. The Holy Quran states, "And there the women have rights similar and equal to those of men over them in equity." It further states, "Whoso does good, whether male or female, and is a believer, shall enter paradise, and they shall not be wronged." These verses clearly show that women and men are equal. Women are inferior to no one, whosoever. For women, there are exactly equal rights as for men. There is thus total equality, and there is no difference whatsoever between the fundamental human rights for women and men. However, it is grossly misunderstood that a large number of people believe that Islam does not give any rights to women, and women are considered inferior, and they have often regarded Islamic women as being backward in the male-dominated world. On the contrary, Islam established great respect and dignity of women and prescribed equal rights for them. The moral, spiritual, and economic equality of men and women as ruled by Islam is unquestionable. Islam has assigned a position of dignity and honor to women. It is appropriate to discuss very briefly the situation of women in the history of Arabia when Islam came to be born through divine instructions. Before the advent of Islam in Arabia, women were not shown any respect and dignity. Women were not given any rights. They were considered as the property of men. Men had a full right and authority over women, and women had no authority whatsoever. Before Islam, women were sold or abandoned as personal commodities. Women were being divided as inheritance, and even a stepson could inherit his stepmother. Women could neither own nor inherit property. In domestic affairs, they had no rights over their children or themselves. If they were abused by their husbands, they had no recourse to divorce. They had no real status in the society, not being respected as wife, mother, or daughter. Women were given little or no education and had no say in religious matters, being regarded as limited in spirituality and intellect. Sons were considered better than girls. The birth of a girl was considered to be a matter of disgrace and extreme shame. In Arab, many tribes used to bury their newborn daughters alive. And some proud Arabs are reported to have buried their newborn daughters with their own hands to escape this ignominy. In Islam, the status of women was simultaneously raised to such high standards that they could no longer be treated as helpless commodities. They were given an equal share in the affairs of life. They were given the right of inheritance. In Islam, a woman is the absolute owner of her own property, and her husband cannot obtain any control over it. And to provide for the household is a man's responsibility, regardless of the fact that the woman is earning or has property. The Holy Quran states, "For men is a share of that which parents and near relations leave, and for women is a share of that which parents and near relations leave." A woman was also given freedom of decision. The Holy Quran says, "O ye who believe, it is not lawful for you to inherit women against their will." The Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him, was so careful concerning the sentiments of women that on one occasion, when he was leading the prayer, he heard the cry of a child and concluded the service quickly, explaining thereafter that as he had heard the cry of the child, he imagined that the child's mother would be distressed as at its cry, and he had therefore concluded the service quickly so that the mother could go to the child and look after it. When during any of his journeys, women were also among the party, he always gave directions that the caravan should move slowly and by easy stages. During a battle, confusion arose among the ranks of the mounted soldiers and the animals became unmanageable. The Holy Prophet fell from his horse and some of the women also fell from their mounts. One of his companions, who was riding a camel immediately behind the Prophet, jumped down and ran towards him crying, "May I be your service, O Messenger of Allah." The Prophet's foot was still in the stirrup. He released it hastily and said to the companion, "Don't bother about me, go and help the women." And he showed a clear example of ladies first. Islam declared equal opportunities to women and men to seek knowledge. The founder of Islam says, "It is the duty of every Muslim man and Muslim woman to seek knowledge." Islam instructs Muslims to protect women all over the world from any abuse and barbarity. Those who mistreat women in so-called Islamic states violate the teachings of the Holy Quran and the Prophet of Islam. I admit that in some Muslim countries, women are not treated well. Stoning women to death, honor killing, neglecting women in taking decisions, depriving them from their basic human rights such as education, work, driving, property, and social activities, beating women and forced and unwilling marriages, all are very sad prospects. These are all misconceptions and misinterpretations of Islamic teachings. And this all happens because of lack of understanding of the social teaching of Islam. These things have nothing to do with Islam and are completely and categorically condemnable. The role which women play in Islamic social system is certainly not of concubines in harem, nor of a society imprisoned in the four walls of their homes, barred from progress and deprived of the four walls of the light of knowledge. Women have different roles in societies. Sometimes a woman appears as a mother, sometimes as a wife, and sometimes as a daughter. All these roles are respected and dignified in Islam. A woman as wife holds a very high position in Islam. The Holy Quran states, "O ye who believe, it is not lawful for you to inherit women against their will, nor should you detain them wrongfully, that you may take away part of that which you have given them, except that they be guilty of flagrant evil, and consort with them in kindness. And if you dislike them, it may be that you dislike a thing wherein Allah has placed much good." Islam gave women right to counsel with their husbands in their affairs. They were no longer deprived from the right to oppose their husbands, fathers, or other male members of the family. They could now stand up to their husbands and talk back to them. They could reason with them and, of course, had the full right to disagree. They could not only be divorced, but they had equal rights to divorce their husbands.